Hello everyone. In this session, we will be looking at what has been termed as one of the most beautiful experiment of the times, and that is Meselson and Stahl's experiment that proved that replication of DNA follows the semi-conservative mode, which is in alignment with what was proposed by Watson and Crick when they proposed the structure of DNA in 1953. What would be the outcomes or understandings from this session? One, how a very simple thought and a well-designed experiment could prove a hypothesis. How use of heavy nitrogen isotope was able to distinguish between two strands of DNA. Use of cesium chloride density gradient centrifugation as a technique could effectively give the results, and of course, through all of this, that the experiment could prove that DNA replication is semi-conservative. Now, both Matthew Meselson and Franklin Stahl were very young when they began these experiments to prove that DNA replication is semi-conservative. Franklin Stahl had already finished his PhD, while Matthew Meselson was in the last stages of his PhD when they decided to collaborate and work on this. As you can see, they conducted their experiment from October 1957 to January 1958, which is a very short duration. But in that short duration, as they worked at Caltech USA, they were able to successfully carry out the experiment and also interpret and give the results. You have a book that is available written by science historian Frederick Lawrence Holmes, who has actually covered the journey both Meselson and Stahl went through as they proved that DNA replication is semi-conservative. What was the focus? Now, the focus was that Watson and Crick's hypothesis suggested that DNA replication is semi-conservative. But as soon as this was proposed, there were a lot of scientists across the world who were looking at the phenomenon, and they suggested that it may not be semi-conservative mode of replication. According to Watson and Crick's hypothesis, as they proposed, when you have a double-stranded DNA, this double-stranded DNA, if it has to undergo replication, then the double-stranded DNA would first turn into two single strands so that the single strands can act as templates on which the new daughter strand can be formed. So therefore, post-replication, according to them, one DNA molecule will have one strand, which is that of the parent, and the other strand that is there of the completely new. So that was called as a daughter strand. Now, this hypothesis was based on the fact that base pairing is complementary. So they had, while describing the structure of the DNA, also said that in the DNA, the base pairing is always complementary. So the idea is that if the two strands, one strand is a poly DA strand, then the other strand will definitely be poly DT strand, because A is complementary to T. And so these would be the two strands present. Now, if the replication follows the point of complementarity, then the daughter strands would also have to be completely complementary to the parent strand. So as you can see, therefore, you will have two DNA, which is 80, 80, 80, 80. So therefore, that was the idea with which Watson and Crick hypothesized that DNA replication is semi-conservative. But this point was debated. And based on the lot of debates that were happening, a lot of discussions that were happening in the scientific world, there were two more hypotheses that came forth. One hypothesis suggested that a double-stranded DNA after replication would lead to one DNA that is completely parental, that means it is conserved, and the other DNA that is formed is completely new. So that is a completely new DNA that is formed, and therefore this was proposed to be, or this was what was called as the conservative mode of replication. Another model or hypothesis was that a double-stranded DNA, being a long DNA, and in fact this was proposed by Max Delbruck, and Max Delbruck said that because DNA is a long DNA, it may not be possible for the entire DNA to become single strands, and hence short segments of the DNA may open up and form the new DNA. So therefore, the hypothesis suggested that on replication or after replication, the two strands of DNA that are available would be having interspersed parent and daughter strands. So therefore, it will not be that one strand is completely parent and one strand is completely daughter, but you would have a mix of both daughter and parent strands in both the DNA. So this was called as the dispersive mode of replication. And Meselson and Stahl took up the challenge to find out which was actually the mode of replication, whether it was what was suggested by Watson and Crick, or it was the conservative mode of replication or dispersive mode of replication. So what was their experimental plan? The first thought that they had was that there should be a way by which they are able to separate DNA. And therefore, they plan to go in for what is called as density gradient centrifugation. One of the reasons being that Meselson was highly skilled in the technique of density gradient centrifugation, as during his PhD, he had used this technique a lot. And so therefore, he was conversant not just with the technique, but also with the interpretation and analysis of the results. Now, what is density gradient centrifugation? So in a density gradient centrifugation, there is a gradient that is formed that is from low density to high density. And if in this gradient, you have the sample loaded, the sample containing molecules of different sizes, then when this is spin it at a very high rate. So the revolutions per minute is very high. And so the force generated is much more than the gravitational force. What is observed is that the entire set of molecules will get distributed in the gradient. But when it settles down in such a way that the molecule's buoyant density matches with the density of the gradient. So those molecules that have low density will be found where the gradient is low density, and those molecules that are heavy will be found where the density in the gradient is high. So based on the buoyant density of the molecules, you will find that the molecules concentrate at a particular region. So that's how molecules can be separated. In case of DNA, they used what is called as the cesium chloride density gradient. Now, the reason for using cesium chloride density gradient centrifugation was that the cesium chloride had a density that matches the density of the DNA, the nucleic acids per se. And so in a density gradient, when you have the density formed from a low to a higher density of cesium chloride, the DNA will concentrate where its buoyant density matches with that of the cesium chloride. So it was observed that at 1.7 grams per cubic centimeter, the buoyant density of DNA matches with that of the cesium chloride density gradient, which was made from 1.55 to 1.75 grams per cubic centimeter. Interestingly, if the sample had a contamination of proteins and RNA, the proteins and RNA were distinctively separated due to the density gradient centrifugation. The proteins remained at a lower density while the RNA settled down because the density of the RNA was much higher. So that was, and also, so therefore it is easy to distinguish the concentrated DNA in the density gradient centrifugation. The second thought that was there, the second focus was to be able to distinguish between the parent strand and the daughter strand. So, because as observed earlier, when you look at all the modes of replication that were proposed, eventually one had to distinguish between the parent strand and the daughter strand, whether it is conservative or whether it is the dispersive mode of replication. And of course, Watson and Crick had already said that in a resultant DNA after replication, one strand will be completely that of the parent and one strand will be completely that of the daughter. So therefore, one had to distinguish between the parent strand and the daughter strand. And to do so, therefore, their focus was to actually be able to distinguish between the two strands. So their thought was that if there is a difference in the density of the parent strand and the daughter strand, then using density gradient centrifugation, they would be able to get two distinctive concentrated bands, one that of the parent strand and the other that of the daughter strand, if the densities of the two were different. So therefore the question arose, how could one work on it such that you have the densities of the parent strand and the daughter strands different? So what was their first trial was that they used what is called as 5-bromouracil. The 5-bromouracil is a base analog and it's an analog of thymidine, but it is heavier than thymidine. So the density of 5-bromouracil is different from that of the thymidine. And so if you have in a DNA adenine being present, instead of thymidine, bromouracil can come and bind to the adenine. So therefore, you would have a base pairing of adenine and bromouracil, but the bromouracil being heavier, the daughter strand should be heavier than that of the parent strand. So that was the idea, because the parent strand, if at all had, then it would have thymidine present. This process, when they carried it out, they found that it was tedious because a lot of 5-bromouracil was required to carry out the experiment, and the incorporation of 5-bromouracil was not as effective as thymidine per se, and hence it would take a lot of time. And also what was observed is that they used for replication the DNA of bacteriophage, and they observed that while carrying out very high speed centrifugation, the DNA of the bacteriophage got sheared. So they would not be able to get a very condensed DNA as the DNA fragmented. So therefore the results were not satisfactory. Hence, they had to think of something else. And so they carried out another way of doing this. They chose to use a heavy isotope of nitrogen. Why nitrogen? Because DNA is made up of polynucleotides. The polynucleotides are in turn containing nucleotides, and every nucleotide has a new nitrogen base. So in the basic structure of the nitrogen base, nitrogen has to be incorporated. So if the bacteria or if the organism is grown in a media containing heavy isotope, then the nucleotide should have the heavy nitrogen within the nitrogen base. And when you have all the nucleotides having the heavy nitrogen in its structure, sum total of all the nucleotides present in a DNA will make the DNA heavy. That is what the thought was. And therefore, they used heavy isotope. Please mind, it is not a radioisotope. It is only a heavy isotope of nitrogen. And what was used was the E. coli DNA, because they found that on using E. coli DNA and subjecting the E. coli DNA to very high speed density gradient centrifugation did not lead to as much shearing as was observed for bacteriophage DNA. And therefore, they found that E. coli DNA was more compatible for the study. And so they went ahead with E. coli DNA, as they did get significant concentrated bands in density gradient centrifugation. And therefore, The results were much better than the first trial, and therefore they went ahead with this concept. Now, we will look at the experiment and the results. So, what was done is that they made two nutrient media. One nutrient media had N15. So, N15 is the heavy nitrogen. And in the other media, which is a usual way by which you have the E. coli growing. So, this is already there as a master culture. And that media has N14, which is the normal nitrogen. So, what was done is that E. coli was taken and was inoculated in the media containing N15, and it was grown for several generations. So, it allowed the bacteria to grow for a large number of generations, with the idea that eventually, after this replication, all the DNA that is present in the E. coli will have N15. And so, the DNA that would be isolated from the E. coli should have a DNA that has N15 incorporated in its structure. So after growing the E. coli in N15 media for several generations, they harvested a little of the E. coli and isolated DNA from that and subjected it to density gradient centrifugation. So, on subjecting it to density gradient centrifugation, they got a concentrated band of DNA. And this concentrated band of DNA was because of the N15 incorporated DNA. Now, this master culture, which was already growing in N14, what they did is they harvested E. coli from this, okay? This must have definitely grown for several generations in the same N14 media. The DNA was isolated from E. coli that was growing in N14, and that isolated DNA was again subjected to density gradient centrifugation. As you can observe, a concentrated DNA band was obtained, but as you very clearly can observe, the N15 DNA was heavier than the N14 incorporated DNA, and hence you could visibly find two different positions at which the DNA was found. So you can actually distinguish between an N15 DNA and an N14 DNA. So that was the basis of their experiment. That was the result that encouraged them to move further. What was then done is that E. coli that had been growing in the N15 media for generations was taken and inoculated in a media, fresh media, containing N14. So now they shifted the E. coli batch from N15 media to N14 media, thinking that on replication, when the daughter DNA would form, the daughter DNA should take up N14 or should have incorporated N14 as a nucleotide synthesized within the bacteria would take up N14. But the parental strand would definitely have the N15, and therefore it would be easy for them to distinguish between the parental strand and the N14. So having done that, they grew the E. coli for about one generation and isolated DNA from it and carried out density gradient centrifugation. What the results that they obtained was extremely encouraging for them, because what they found is that they got a concentrated band, neither where there was a band for N14 DNA and nor at a position where there was a band for N15, but they got a new position of the concentrated DNA suggestive of the fact that the DNA contained both N15 and N14. So they considered that the DNA that is formed is hybrid. Now, if it is a hybrid DNA, then the first thing that they again, very effectively tried to look at is what is the position. And also they had, a peak for everything. And with that peak, they were able to understand that you have different positions at which, or different densities at which you had the DNA getting concentrated. So you could separate a hybrid DNA from an N14 DNA from an N15 DNA. So that is something that was effectively showing that you could distinguish different DNA based on density. Now, with this result, they definitely were able to say that it is not the conservative mode of replication. Why? Because if it were the conservative mode of replication, you would definitely have one band at the N14 position and the other band at the N15 position, understanding that the parent DNA would be conserved. That means both the strands of the parent would form one DNA, and you would have another DNA formed which would have daughter strands. So it would be completely new with N14. But that was not what was happening. They did not find two distinct bands formed. Instead, they found a hybrid DNA intermediate between the N14 and N15. And so therefore, they said it is not the conservative mode of replication. But the contention was still there for semi-conservative mode of replication and the dispersive mode of replication, because in both the cases, you would get hybrid DNA. In case of semi-conservative, you would get the hybrid such that one strand is completely parent and one strand is completely daughter, while in case of the dispersive mode of replication, you would have both the strands having almost equal proportions of the daughter and the parent strand. So what was done is to look at whether it is dispersive or whether it is semi-conservative, they carried out the experiment further. So what they did is the E. coli that was growing, the E. coli that was taken from N15 and grown in N14, from this media, E. coli was taken and inoculated again in a media, fresh media that had N14. So now they no longer provided N15 at all. They only grew it in N14 again. So once you have the DNA growing for one generation, the DNA was isolated and it was again subjected to density gradient centrifugation. And the result was interesting. They found that they had one DNA that they obtained at N14 and one DNA concentrated band was obtained again at the N14, N15. So, therefore, their basic contention now was that if it were dispersive mode of replication, one would never have got a completely N14 DNA. But it would have had just the N14, N15 hybrid, the band becoming broader and broader. Since you had two distinct bands being formed, they concluded that the DNA replication is semi-conservative. How is what we will look at when you look at the schematic diagram of all the three models. So in the semi-conservative model, if this is the parental DNA, which has both the strands being N15, then according to the semi-conservative mode, these two strands will act as templates and the new daughter DNA will be formed. Correct? So both the DNA that is formed will be a hybrid. One strand will be N15 and the other strand will be N14. Same over here. Therefore, what was observed after the first generation that grew in N14, they got an N14, N15 hybrid DNA. That stands true for the way this is explained. Now, when they carried it out for the second generation, as seen, they got a concentrated DNA band at the position where you have N14 DNA. And they also got what is called as the N14, N15 hybrid DNA. So, suppose you consider this as a parent DNA now, for the second generation or for the second replication cycle, then one of the parent strands is going to be N15, while the other strand is going to be N14. So effectively, one parent strand over here is N14 and one parent strand over here is N15. But the daughter strand that will be formed will always have N14 because the E. coli is being grown in N14 containing medium. Consider then for the second DNA as well. This was also obtained. So when you allow this also to further form the, so when all E. coli form, go through the second replication cycle, you would get one hybrid DNA and one completely N14 DNA. That's the reason why this one complete N14 DNA was forming a concentrated band at the position of N14, while the hybrid DNA formed a concentrated band at the position where N14, N15 hybrid would separate out. So this clearly explains why it is a semi-conservative mode of replication. In this case, as earlier mentioned, had it been conservative, in the first generation study itself, one would have got two bands. But one did not get two bands, one got only one band, and that too a hybrid DNA band. So therefore, this was negated at this step itself. But for dispersive mode of replication, one would get the same N14, N15 DNA hybrid because you can observe that both the DNA would have parts of the parent and parts of the daughter DNA interspersed. So therefore, effectively, this entire DNA would be an N14, N15 hybrid, and this entire DNA would also be N14, N15 hybrid. And therefore, you would definitely get a N14, N15 hybrid DNA concentrated band, which means that at the first generation level or the first replication cycle level, you would have a contention between whether it is semi-conservative and whether it is the dispersive model, because the result for both would be the same. So when subjected to the second replication, if it were the dispersive mode of replication, you would find that all the DNA that would form after the replication should have N14 and N15, because each DNA would have parts of the daughter strand and parts of the parent strand. So therefore, what would happen in a dispersive mode of replication would be that the hybrid DNA concentrated band itself would become broader and broader. But that was not what was happening. Instead, what had happened is a new band was observed at the N14 position and the N14 and N15 hybrid DNA band was becoming thinner compared to the first time. So therefore, from this observation, they were able to prove that DNA replication is semi-conservative mode of replication. So let us make the conclusions as per their journey. They concluded that the nitrogen in each DNA molecule divided evenly between the two subunits of DNA and that the subunits stayed intact throughout the observed replication cycles. They made the conclusion because the intermediate band had a density halfway between the heavy and light DNA bands. They also concluded that each new DNA double helix contained one parental subunit, which supported the semi-conservative replication. Assuming that DNA consists of two subunits, if a parent passes on one subunit of DNA to its offspring, then half of the parental DNA is conserved in the offspring DNA and half of the parental DNA is not, so semi-conservative. For every parental DNA molecule, two new molecules were made. Therefore, the amount of DNA after each replication increased by a factor of 2, and therefore the concentrated band that was observed in the density gradient would increase. Meselson and Stahl related their findings to the structure of DNA and replication mechanism proposed by Watson and Crick. Thus, DNA replication was proved to be semi-conservative through a beautifully designed and described experiment. Thank you.